Good morning, good afternoon. Thank you for joining our online conference today. I'm Anna Maria Maida, Professor of Economics at Georgetown University at the School of Foreign Service and Department of Economics. I'm honored to be hosting and moderating this event. Before we kick off, I would like to thank our sponsors, the Georgetown University Global Economic Challenges Network, the Einaudi Institute for Economics and Finance, the Center for Economic Policy Research, and the Solvay Brussels Schools of Economics and Management at Université Libre de Bruxelles. More specifically, I would like to thank Frank Bella, the Edmond Villani Professor of Economics at Georgetown, and Michael Castagnera, the Director of FNRS and Professor of Economics at Solvay Brussels School of Economics and Management. Professors Bella and Castagnera have been the force behind the Global Economic Challenges Network that brings together academics and policymakers to discuss the most pressing economic issues that face our world. Today's topic is the Ukrainian refugee crisis. The Russian invasion of Ukraine has resulted in a massive exodus of individuals from Ukraine to neighboring and other European countries. According to the United Nations, the UNHCR, more than 5 million Ukrainians have left their country since February 24th, which is when the invasion started. The arrival of such a large number of individuals in such a short period of time is a great challenge for destination countries. The two main aspects of this challenge are the following. First, how to facilitate the integration of refugees, given that by definition, refugees have not prepared their move, unlike economic migrants. So they may not have the language and the skills needed to perform at their best in the labor market of the destination countries. Second, how to manage the impact of refugees on the destination countries from an economic point of view, so from a labor market point of view, from a fiscal point of view, but also from a non-economic point of view. From a policy point of view, it is noteworthy that the EU has granted Ukrainians immediate permissions to stay for at least 1 year, access to the labor market, and education for children. To lead the discussion, we have invited three distinguished scholars whom I want to thank for participating in this event. They're leading experts on immigration and refugees, and they will shed light on best policies to facilitate integration of refugees and to manage their impact on the destination countries. We will be together for 75 minutes. Please use the Q&A button on Zoom, and we will try to answer as many questions as possible. I will start with Professor Dasman. You are Professor of Economics at University College of London and the founding director of the Center for Research and Analysis of Migration. You held visiting professor positions at Harvard, Princeton, Stanford, Yale, and UC Berkeley. You're one of the most prolific and insightful scholars of migration in economics, and you have been widely recognized, for example, as president of the European Association of Labour Economists and as fellow of the British Academy. My first question to you is, how best can destination countries deal with the arrival of Ukrainian refugees? And what can be learned from past experiences with refugees?
Yes, thanks a lot, Anna Maria, for your introduction. And yes, it is actually the case that Europe is again in the midst of a huge immigration wave. And this one is far larger than the one we have experienced in 2015. Therefore, is likely to pose far larger challenges. And yes, we have seen a lot of research on refugee migration, in particular during the last 10 years, and we have learned something from that research. So I would like to make 6 points, which I believe are very important to address the question you just posed. First of all, the labor market. As you pointed out, refugees, very different from economic migrants, usually come unprepared. The doctor, the surgeon who was working in early February in Kiev certainly didn't expect to be 4 weeks later somewhere in Germany or in Spain or in Italy, and therefore lacks many of the skills which are absolutely essential to transfer his or her skills to the labor market of the country where he migrates to. But in order to transfer the skills productively, we need to give access to the labor market. And that has been something which in previous waves of refugee migration was not always granted. The labor market is certainly the best integrator, not just in the economy, but also socially. To give the opportunity to work is what I would think the first very important lesson we have learned from previous migration waves. Well, fortunately, in this particular case, most or nearly all European countries are very generous in that respect. So access to the labor market of EU countries is actually granted at least for the first year of new arrivals. Secondly, coming back to my example of the surgeon, to be productive in the labor market, you need to have skills which allow you to transfer your knowledge to the needs of the labor market of the receiving country. Language here is very important, but other skills are likewise important. And these skills need to be provided to refugees as early as possible and possibly while engagement in the labor market is ongoing. Third, give refugees choices. So in the past, we had in many European countries the policy that refugees were allocated to particular areas, to particular geographic locations, and often locations where they lacked the support of networks and where economic conditions were potentially adverse to their particular needs. So the most efficient allocation is an allocation where refugees can actually choose where they want to live and where they want to work, something which I think we need to take very serious because, arrival policies of allocations have been shown to be quite detrimental to labor market success. Fourth, we need to plan ahead. Past experiences have witnessed that governments that do not have a clear, coordinated, and well-communicated a plan for dealing with refugee migration, often came into situations where those migration waves were politically, very opportunistically exploited. That shouldn't be the case. So we need a plan on national level, a plan on European level. I think a good example how not to do it was the quarreling across Europe, who actually should now take refugees from Syria and Africa during the 2015 crisis, that clearly was not very helpful. Again, it looks like solidarity is far stronger during this crisis than it was during a previous crisis. Fifth, we need to engage local communities. The worst scenario is one where refugees are hidden away behind some wall and local populations believe speculate about those people in all types of colorful ways without actually ever having met them. So the engagement of local communities, the contact between local communities and refugees is extremely important and should be pushed in any way possible. And sixth, we need to look ahead. We need to acknowledge the potential for a backlash, to foresee the political fallout, a refugee crisis beyond the immediate stages may actually bring, in particular when we talk about magnitudes of the kind we are seeing at the moment. In Europe, a wave of empathy towards Syrian refugees in 2015, which was symbolized by the tragic death of a Kurdish boy who had been washed up on Turkish beaches, quickly gave way to hostility after the violence that unfolded on New Year's Eve in Cologne only a few months later. Massive migration flows will inevitably, even if they are if they are initially seen with a lot of sympathy, create some resentment, some anxiety, and that can be exploited opportunistically by radical political movements. We have seen that many times in the past, and I think we need to be prepared for that by providing openness, transparency, good communication about how refugees are being integrated, about the contributions they potentially make. And again, of course, the labor market, coming back to my first point, is always the best integrator. The challenges this time are certainly huge. The influx of people from Ukraine, however, is also from Ukraine, is also an opportunity for European nations to show strength and solidarity in the face of such human tragedy. A very positive sign is that those countries along the Ukrainian border that were most skeptical about refugee migration in 2015 have been far more accommodating this time. And let's hope that this will be also so in the future. Let me just conclude with a quick link. We have at our Center for Research and Analysis of Migration, CREAM, a website on the Ukrainian migration crisis, which we update on a daily basis. I think maybe somebody can put that in the chat. So if you click on that, you will find a lot of information, a lot of research as well on this particular crisis, which you may find informative and interesting. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Dasman. Next to Professor Oriola, thank you for joining us. You are a professor at Toulouse School of Economics and the Vice President for International Relations at the University of Toulouse One Capitole since 2010. You have contributed to the academic literature with several papers on IO, labor and development. You are the author of the award-winning book, Pour en finir avec les mafias. You're a fellow of several research institutions, including CEPR. You chair the EEA Standing Committee on Women in Economics from 2015 to 2018. And you are also a member of the Council d'Analyse Économique, which is the French Council of Economic Advisors, and a member of the Administrative Council of the French Office for Immigration and Integration. Let me ask you the following question, Professor Oriola. What is your view of the impact of refugees in the countries of arrival? And which policies and destination can affect the impact and the integration of refugees?
Thank you very much for this kind introduction and for this event. I think it's very important that we have this discussion. I would like to maybe, if you allow me, to talk a little bit about what happened in France just last weekend. We had our presidential election, and the major theme of this presidential election throughout was immigration. And the extreme right party, like Le Pen and Zemmour, together, they represented at the last round 32% of voters that cast their vote against really immigration. That was really the theme. And one reason for that, I think, and it's not only France, the Brexit, also one major theme with that, in Poland, in Hungary, we have extremist right-wing parties that also are against immigration. And it's a bit funny how they deal now with the refugee crisis from Ukraine when we compare to how they deal with the refugee crisis from Syria. I mean, there is a huge difference there. But in Europe, we had this huge immigration crisis, refugee crisis in 2015, and it has consequences in terms of at least the poll and political economy. In France, just to give you one indication, one anecdote that explains this really anti-immigration sentiment, we had this professor, this teacher that was killed by a refugee. He was from Russia, actually, he was Chechen, but still he was a refugee. So there is this idea, and this was in the campaign, that immigration is really, and especially of refugees from a Muslim country, is something that will lead to terrorism, to unemployment, and to a fiscal cost. So this is really the view. And of course, it's fair, I think, to ask the question of, what is the economic impact of hosting these refugees? I mean, it's a fair question. We have an obligation to host them, but is it a cost or is it an opportunity? And very interestingly, empirical studies show that it is an opportunity. So there are problems, clearly. There is a difference between the way we deal with the Ukrainian crisis in Europe. We are much more generous and much more welcoming than with the Syrian one. So we see the cultural aspect here, but still the question of how profitable it could be for the EU economy to host these people is an important question. And so I cannot resist the opportunity to mention David Card, that gets the Nobel Prize in 2021 for precisely showing that hosting refugees, it was Miami in this paper, is a boost for the economy. It's not a burden. Clearly this boost, there are conditions for it. And one condition, I think Christian mentioned it already, is that this refugee can integrate the labor market quickly. And to do that, in general, you need to master the language. So there are really bottleneck there that can prevent the dividend of hosting refugees. But still, in Miami, it was a good thing for both the labor market, the unemployment rate decrease, but also the activity. The recent refugee crisis we had in Europe, so in Germany, and they took on board more than 1 million people. So it was in 2015, so we have like now 7 years to see what happened there. In Sweden also, it's a shock of 2% of their population that they took on board due to this crisis. It's very hard to measure exactly the impact, but here again, in the long run, the simulation of the IMF are a boost for the growth of Germany and a boost for the growth of Sweden. However, this depends on the fact that the immigrants work. Well, there are several channels. The first one is like a Keynesian boost, because you host these people, you have to give them shelter, you have to give them food. So you spend more, and this is consumed right away. So this gives some economic boost. There is an issue of participation to the labor market. So here, it's really language and ability to work. And it depends if it is done quickly or if it takes a lot of time. A study shows that if it takes a lot of time, more than a year, then the refugees have a very hard time to catch up with the other immigrants and the economic immigrant. Interestingly, also, refugees boost the creation of firms, and entrepreneurs are overrepresented among immigrants and refugees included. They also boost international trade. There is a beautiful paper exploiting the administrative spread of Vietnamese refugees in the US that show that it leads to when the ban of trade with Vietnam was lifted by the US like 20 years down the road, it yielded an important it's a boot in the international trade with Vietnam for this area where these refugees were settled. And if you have highly qualified immigrant refugees, they also boost innovation. So these are the channels through which both short-term and long-term that this population will bring to the economic to the economy of the EU. So now, looking at the crisis we have here, there are differences between the refugee crisis of 2015 and the Ukrainian crisis right now. One big difference is that the population is very different. The refugees from 2015 in Europe, there were for 70% of them, 75% of them, male. The Ukrainian refugees are all female, children or elderly. The Syrian and the refugee of 2015, they were young because it was very dangerous to flee, to reach Europe. And so more than 50% of them, they were younger than 25 years old. So in age to work, male and rather not educated. So this explains also how they integrate in the labor market. Now we have children, we have elderly people, and fortunately, we have women that in Ukraine, like elsewhere, are highly educated. Women are more educated than men on average. And so certainly we might hope to host them and they will contribute to the economy of Europe. And I hope we will come back to that. It depends, of course, on how well they are integrated, how well they can participate to the labor market, and how well they can reunite with their family. Because right now, the men are in Ukraine and the women are at the border in Poland. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Oriola. Let me introduce Professor Boeri next. Thank you very much for joining us. You are a professor of economics at Bocconi University and have been the Centennial Professor at London School of Economics. You have authored a great many academic articles on labor economics. You have worked at OECD and have been a consultant at OECD, IMF, World Bank, European Commission, ILO, and the Italian government. You have served as president of the Italian Social Security Administration. You have been director of the Rudolfo de Benedetti Foundation since 1998, founder of the economic information website La Voce and VoxEU, as well as the scientific director of the International Festival of Economics in Torino. Let me ask you the following question. What are the main challenges we face in terms of integration of refugees?
Well, first of all, thank you for having me at this very important meeting. I think that there are three main differences in this wave of refugees with respect to previous ones. And two of them have already been mentioned by Christian and Emmanuel. The first one is related to its magnitude. We received about 5 million people over a 2 month horizon, while in the case of a Syrian crisis, we receive about 2 million people over 2 years. And most of them were actually stopped at the doors of Europe in Turkey, while in this case, they are entering Europe to a large extent. The massive flow to Poland are clearly above 3 million today. And the projections of UNHCR are of about 6 million people coming to Western Europe in the context of this crisis. The second difference is in the composition. Here, we don't have many men in working age. We have 35%, you know, more than one third of children in schooling age. And we have many mothers with children. So that's clearly a different composition and one that has different challenges than the previous waves. But there is also a third difference, and this is in the policy response of Europe. Europe this time activated a new tool which is the Temporary Protection Directive, something that allows the type of self-sorting that Christian was also indicating before as being very important. So now refugees are allowed to move within Europe. Actually, we pay for their movement, for their transportation, so they can choose where to go. And that's very, very, very important. And we'll prevent that we get caught into endless discussion about the allocation mechanism. So I think that now the attention should be very much on policies that ease the integration of the refugees into our society, broadly speaking, not only in our economies, but broadly speaking in our societies. And here we should really work hard in identifying positive examples from previous episodes. Two of them, in my view, are particularly promising. The first one is an experiment that was carried out in Italy in the Regione Piemonte, which is a northern region, where refugees that were hosted in centers were offered the opportunity, and this was in the context of a randomized controlled trial, of having some mediation services, placement services, language training, and also a skill recognition, trying to uncover the potential behind their curricula by specialized people, you know, psychiatrists, cultural mediators, and the teachers. The program was actually personalized because it took place during the COVID crisis, so there was no possibility to do group training, collective training in this context. Now, the evaluation study from this randomized control trial suggests that there was a huge impact on employment rates, an increase of about 30% in relative rate in terms with respect to the control group. It had also a positive effect on earnings of the beneficiaries of the scheme. So this is a very promising scheme, as also it was very effective because it costed about 3,000 euro per person. The other experiment that in my view is worth recalling is one that concerns school integration, because given the large number of children involved, it's extremely important that they are integrated into our school system rapidly. This was done in Turkey, actually, and the experiment consisted in offering a number of support activities to Syrian children. About 3.5 hours per week were devoted to civic attitude, the social interactions, and various type of activities that were aimed not only at developing cognitive skills, but also non-cognitive skills. And that also seemed to be extremely successful, and that also was subject to a very serious evaluation study. And it suggests that the children involved were more keen to cooperate, were avoiding the type of conflicting behaviors that had been observed among refugees and natives in other contexts. So these two experiences, in my view, are extremely interesting, valuable, and also can be implemented on a relatively large scale, because also the scheme done in Turkey is very cost effective. In that case, actually, the cost was about 8.2 euros per pupil. So very, 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 very low cost. So I think we need really to work hard on these experiences. There should be a lot of exchange of information across governments. Now, really, given the option, the window of opportunity offered by the Temporary Protection Directive of the EU, really now the task is on government, on local communities, on public employment services, because as Christian was emphasizing, the integration is very much in the labor market, but not only. And an additional area where more work has to be done compared to previous episode is one of childcare facilities, because clearly all of these mothers, women, will be in a position to work only if childcare support is offered to them, given the nature of the refugee waves that we are experiencing.
Thank you very much, Professor Boeri. Thank you all for these initial remarks. Next, I'm going to ask you a second round of more specific questions, and I'm going to start again with Professor Dasman. Professor Dasman, you talked about policies that allow migrants to move freely, and that was mentioned actually also by the other two speakers. And these policies allow migrants to go where they think they're gonna do best from a labor market point of view, and are in contrast to dispersal policies that try to disperse the burden welcoming refugees. But there is a third option, policies that match refugees with specific firms and better performing labor markets, with admittedly pretty complicated algorithms. What do you think about this third option?
Well, I think what is crucial is, as Tito also pointed out, and that's a very positive aspect of what we are seeing at the moment, the Temporary Protection Directive. What is crucial is to give immigrants the opportunity to go where they believe the jobs are and their economic situation will be most favorable. The problem is that they may not have full information about the labor market of the country to which they come. And that information has to be provided. I believe that networks which build very quickly are extremely powerful in providing that information. Now, alternatives are, of course, to use, I think you may refer to a particular academic paper which uses particular algorithms to find the optimal matches. Well, that is, in my view, something which may work, but I'm not sure that it is easily implementable on a very large scale. I think what we should try to do is to actually provide information mechanisms to inform refugees about where jobs are, to give them the opportunity. And there, of course, we are again talking about skills and in particular language capital, to give them the opportunity to access information sources, to make it easier for them to access information sources and to allow them to take full advantage of existing networks and networks which will now build up very quickly while this crisis is unfolding. And that should lead to the outcomes we would like to see.
Thank you, Professor Dasman. Do you think that there are potential issues with congestion effects when network sizes expand? There is some research in the literature that shows that there might be strong labor market competition between immigrants from the same country of origin. So besides the benefits from the networks, there might be potential negative effects also in terms of political backlash by the destination country, by public opinion in the destination country.
I mean, sure. I mean, we are talking about a very massive inflow this time. We are talking also about an inflow which, from the demographic perspective, is very specific. Many children, many women, but also many elderly people. And of course, this will have an impact on labor markets. But I mean, the free mobility idea within the European Union is addressing that point to some extent. So if there is a lack of workers in particular professions in Germany, but in excess supply in Sweden or in Portugal, then workers can move across borders. And after the Great Recession, we have seen substantial movements across borders of workers from EU countries between EU nation states, and that relieved some labor markets and addressed scarcity problems in other labor markets. Now, again, the Temporary Protection Directive allows those movements of refugees across national borders as well as within countries, and should address some of those issues. Nevertheless, of course, I agree that given the magnitude, this may actually be quite a substantial challenge. Now, let me add there one point. So Tito very clearly pointed out that integration into society is very important, as did Emmanuel, and of course that is very true. However, the problem with this refugee migration, as with refugee migrations in general, compared to economic migrations, is that with an economic migration, the migrant decides whether and how long he would like to remain in a particular country. With refugee migration, there is a huge amount of uncertainty. The conflict decides how long refugees want to remain. The conflict decides whether there is an opportunity to actually return. That creates uncertainty on the side of the migrant, but of course also on the side of firms and employers who would like to actually work with refugees, employ refugees, skill refugees up to their particular needs. And how to address that is complex and very difficult.
Thank you, Professor Dasman. Let me move on to another question that was also asked by somebody in the audience. The demographics of Ukrainian refugees are both an opportunity and a challenge. And by the way, this is a question to all three speakers because you all mentioned this point. So rather than young men, we have a lot of women, kids, and elderly moving. So from a political economy point of view, this might be an advantage because it is less likely to create political backlash. But there are definitely challenges. So for example, we have a question from Camilla Comiteri, who would like you to expand on the point that there is a particular risk of gender-based violence, that foreign women workers might be more vulnerable, both as they move and when they arrive to the destination country. And so how best to design policies to protect these more vulnerable populations of refugees?
I think everybody is asked, so maybe Tito or Emmanuel would want to.
Please go ahead, any one of the three speakers. You are muted, Tito.
No doubt that the composition of the refugees population is one that requires also a particular attention to gender issues, and clearly in that respect, it's very important that all the type of tools that are currently being used in Europe to fight against the gender discrimination are activated. In principle, the directive allows for that to happen because all the social protection measures are extended to the refugees, but clearly there may be delays and difficulties in doing that, and this type of delays should be clearly addressed timely in order to avoid that this happens. I think that there is an advantage that we have with respect to previous episode, and this is that there is more acceptance, especially in Eastern Europe, that was a part of Europe that was in the past particularly against immigration flows. And the higher acceptance that we got there, I think, is a byproduct more of cultural reasons, historical reasons, as well as religious reasons that made the refugees more accepted in these countries. But the risk of a backlash is always there, and we should be extremely careful in avoiding it. So clearly, it's very important right now to work hard to make a huge investment in integration. That's very important in terms of a social cohesion. Otherwise, we run the risk of getting very serious social conflicts in the future. The pressure may not be that much in terms of the labor market, but they may be in other areas if we don't succeed in this. So that's certainly something we should really devote a lot of attention. I do not see as yet in governments, both in Eastern Europe as well as in Western Europe, so much attention to these issues that are so important.
Thank you. Let me move on to a question to Professor Oriola. Given that you know the specific experience of France, can you tell us about programs that help the integration of immigrants in general and of refugees in France?
Yes, thank you about this question. Well, we have a program in France that are on that are for any type of immigrant, but we use them also for refugee. And then we have specific program for refugee, but in general, they are covering a few hundreds people. They are never evaluated, so it's very hard to learn anything from this contract. But one of them that is for all the non-European citizens that will join France and that are above 16 is what we call the contrat d'intégration républicaine, so the Republican Integration Contract. And like what exists also in other European countries, you have a civic formation, which is a couple of days, and some training about how we live in France and what is the way of living in France, and of course training to teach French. So you are evaluated, the immigrants are evaluated in their skills, in their language skills, and then they are ventilated in programs that can move from 100 hours to 600 hours. There has been no evaluation of that, but one of the ancestors, the former contrat d'intégration républicaine. And very interestingly, what he showed, and so it's a bit related to the issue about how well we can hope women will do, is that the impact of this program, the main impact of it, was not really to improve participation in the labor market of the refugee or an immigrant. The main impact was that they suddenly learn about the advantage you might have if you are registered at the unemployment agency, for instance. So suddenly they were more participating to the labor market, but they were not working. They were simply knowing the rule, the French rule, to improve their situation. So that's the only evaluation we have. So it's very sad. And I must stress that in the French context, we have no way to follow immigrants. The reason is that it's forbidden by law, to collect what we call ethnic statistics. So we don't know what people, how they integrate. I mean, it's crazy. I think it's really crazy as economists that care about this problem. I mean, how can you have valid policy if you have no idea of how people integrate? And so that's a big issue in France. And so we don't know much. That's the sad truth. We are not very attractive neither because of our anti-immigration policy. Even the Ukrainian refugees, they are not rushing towards France. So that's the reality of what's going on in my country.
So there are clearly very high social costs and economic costs from this peculiarity of the French statistical system. Any possibility that this might change any discussion about this?
Well, it's a Conseil constitutionnel, so it's a higher law institution in France that says if something is constitutional or not, that say to INSEE that they cannot collect these statistics. So we have very focused study sometimes with authorization, but the baseline is that you cannot. We try, as economists, of course, we need statistics. It's, if you break the thermometer, you don't have, of course, you don't have a fever, but that's, and I think one of the reasons why immigration is so sensitive in France is precisely because we have no information. The last poll that the INSEE did was that 25% of French people had a grandparent, grandfather, or grandmother that were not, that were an immigrant. So France is really a country of immigration by geographical position, but also by the level of wealth. So, but the fantasy that we have, we are French from forever, and we have a French culture, and the immigrants are jeopardizing us. That's really the narrative, and there is no way to fight against that without statistics, in fact.
Thank you very much, Professor Oriola. I'm going to go back to Professor Dasman with another question, and it is about certification of refugees that they have from back in Ukraine. How to allow a recognition of refugee certifications? We know that Ukrainian refugees are more skilled than refugees in other refugee waves, so it is especially important to recognize their achievements and certifications. But at the same time, there is also an issue with quality control in the sense that the destination countries need to make sure that the standards of the host are satisfied. And related to that, there is also a question from the audience, from Matthias de Batripont, who asks, what about the possibility to rely on Ukrainian refugee teachers to teach Ukrainian children? So you have skills which are specific for this population, and so they could be taken advantage of to help in the integration of these refugees.
Yes, thanks, Anna Maria. So let me answer that question by a little bit wider. So this particular situation at the moment is extremely dynamic. The demographic composition is extremely dynamic. We will not have the same demographic composition in 1 year time. We don't even know whether we have a refugee crisis in 1 year time. That very much depends on how this conflict will develop. So any kind of, and that of course makes things extremely complicated. We can also not expect that 12.5 or 12.8% of the population which now has crossed European borders will stay permanently in European countries. So that makes integration policies, of course, very, very complex and very difficult. We shouldn't expect that because we don't want Ukraine we don't want to deprive Ukraine from very important skills, which will be needed should this conflict hopefully come to an end very soon. And that brings me to your point of certifications. So the transfer of certifications or the requirement of certifications, first of all, differs dramatically across European countries. Germany, for instance, is at the one extreme. If you want to become a certified baker, you need to go through a 3 year apprenticeship training scheme. On the other hand, if you are in the UK, you can just start buying some flour and mix it with water and bake your bread. So the access to those occupations differs very much between European countries. And the investment in some countries, such as Germany, for instance, to acquire certifications or even to only transfer certifications is again, dependent very much on how refugees will assess this particular conflict. So suppose somebody would like to become a baker, would therefore have to undergo a few years of training. Now, to be a certified baker will not be of much value when you then go back to Kiev. So that investment would be wasted. That will very much affect the decision to acquire certifications or to acquire particular skills for particular labor markets. So those European countries which are having very low thresholds of certifications will and are much easier to access for immigrants as well as for refugees. That makes big differences. Matthias' question on Ukrainian teachers, yes, I mean, of course, I think, and we have seen similar, I think, attempts during the Syrian crisis, at least in Germany, so that you try to use the specialized knowledge of those populations to train themselves, to help themselves, and very clearly this should be done in this particular circumstance as well. And I'm quite optimistic that that we will see developments. We have learned a lot over the last decade how to integrate these populations.
Thank you very much, Professor Dasman. So there is a question from the audience, from Piroska Nagy, about internally displaced people. Is there any role for the EU in this process? And what do we know about internally displaced Ukrainians? For any of the speakers? It is, of course, much more difficult to keep track of internally displaced people because they don't cross borders. There are some estimates, and I think there are in the website at CREAM on the number of internally displaced people. But that's a population that, of course, given the war, given the ongoing war, is much more difficult to keep track of and to help.
I mean, maybe I can just say, so of course, again, this is a situation which is very much in flux. We have seen security concerns in areas of Ukraine which were of no concern maybe 2 weeks earlier, and this will again change. So we will see populations internally moving around as long as this conflict will continue in this particular, this war will continue in this particular way. But whatever happens at the moment will not be a good basis for any policies. So I think one needs to wait a little bit until things have evolved, developed, and settled to address such movements within Ukraine. Of course, when the conflict comes to an end, everybody will want to go back to where he or she has his or her home, and we will see movements in the opposite directions. But at the moment, I think it's very hard to draw any conclusions from these internal movements we are seeing at present.
It's good that you mention return migration, because I have a question myself about return migration, and I see a question by Alfonso Arpaia in the audience for, again, everybody. So many Ukrainians fleeing their homes are planning to go back, and actually some are already doing so, probably prematurely, even though the war is not over. So what is the best way to manage the return of Ukrainian refugees? And Alfonso Arpaia asks, is there a possible inefficiency of refugee location when they expect to go back to Ukraine later? Don't they risk staying too much in Poland, Hungary, and other countries neighboring Ukraine? any of the speakers please go ahead about this question about return migration and the possible inefficiencies in the location of refugees given this possibility in the future?
What we know, it's true that uncertainty, uncertainty about your status, about your ability to settle in a country, etc., has been shown to delay a lot integration, economic integration. So a few years down the road, refugees have a penalty in terms of integration compared to economic migrants because of the reason it was mentioned at the beginning of the discussion, and the traumatism, the fact that they don't know for, let's say, 8 months what's going to happen to them instead of six, make a big difference in terms of the integration. So I totally agree with the idea that if they believe they are going to go back and they cannot in the end, this will have consequences in terms of how quickly they are going to learn the languages, the skills they need to integrate economically in Europe, etc. So of course, it has a huge impact, lasting impact, the way it happened in the next few months. Hopefully, they will be able to go back.
This is a very difficult question. You know, we have families that have been split in two, and it's quite understandable that they may wish to go back as soon as they can to their town of origin. And we already see, indeed, return migration to take place, even if the Ukraine is certainly not a safe place to be. And clearly, you know, that leads to an inefficient allocation of people. I don't think only about Poland. I think about Moldova. You know, there is a country of 2.5 million people receiving about 500,000 refugees. So clearly, the absorption capacity of a country of this type is, and also is a poor country with not certainly a buoyant labor market to date. So clearly, there are problems of this type, and unfortunately, there is little that can be done in the short run because clearly, as the conflict goes on, and there are clearly people involved in the war. But I think unavoidably the horizon of the move will be somewhat longer than what we thought, also because towns have to be rebuilt. So there are not the conditions for a large-scale return migration to take place. And therefore, perhaps other consideration will sooner or later prevail. And there is something that works in favor of a better allocation of people, and this is the presence of large enclaves of Ukrainians in Germany, in Italy, in Spain, in other countries that may offer better labor market conditions than Eastern Europe.
Thank you, Professor Boeri. I actually would like to ask you the next question. As an academic and as president of the Italian Social Security Administration, you have focused in the past on the fiscal impact of immigrants and refugees. Can you tell us about what you have found in your previous work, and how do you think it applies to the wave of Ukrainian refugees? Also, considering the fiscal effects are in the mind of voters, as Professor Oriol mentioned, there has been a lot of discussion of immigration during the French elections. And I saw, for example, on the right, issues related to social services and migrants being brought up very often. So what do we know about fiscal effects of immigrants and refugees, and in particular in the Italian context that you know better? And this question is again open to everybody. Professor Dasman has a very nice paper on the UK with Tommaso Frattini. So these are important issues. We would like to know what you think about them.
Thank you, Anna Maria. This is a very important issue. I think there are two types of misperception that are very much present in the mind of many Europeans, and perhaps they give a possibility to populists to really use this type of misperception. The first one concerns the number of migrants in each of our countries. There is clearly a very extended overestimation of the number of migrants and also of the percentage of illegal migrants in our countries. In Italy, to give an example, they believe that the 1 out of 4 people living in Italy is a migrant, while we are at about 1 every 10 persons. So clearly, that's a very strong misperception, and that widely spread across population. The second misperception concerns the work and the funding of a welfare system, and notably of the pension system. People do not understand how a pay-as-you-go public retirement scheme operates. They think that it's simply like a bank account that people do deposit money during their lifetime, and then when we retire, they can draw money out of this bank account. They don't understand the intergenerational transfer that is being operated, and that clearly suggests that you need to have a younger population, and that the inflows of migrants who are younger could clearly be very beneficial, at least in the short run, maybe not in the long run, because in the long run, also these people withdraw pension at some stage. But in the short run, certainly, that's a very key way of financing the system. Now, if you do informational campaigns that address each of these two issues, you may get some results. So if you explain to people how many migrants there are, they may sooner or later believe the true numbers and move their estimates towards something which is closer to reality. If you try and explain, I'm saying this also based on informational experiments that have been carried out in Italy and in other countries, if you try and explain to people how a pension system operates, they could understand, although it's not that easy and intuitive, that there are this type of transfer taking place. The problem is making the connection between the two issues. So people may understand that the system works better when you have, and it's can improve its balance when there are more younger people contributing to the system. And they also would understand that there are less migrants, and these migrants are young and whatever, you can inform them. But from this, to draw the conclusion that you need more migrants, that's very hard. Also because those that do not make the connection often are people who are biased, who have very strong prejudice and ideologically against. They refuse actually to make the type of logical connection that should follow from this type of information. And clearly here there is a huge responsibility of the way politicians have been working on this. I think I've been personally working on tweets, languages, and you see that among especially right-wing populists, there is a tendency to really use very radical terms, hate speeches, related to migration issues. And that may be a way to really push their electorates towards the very far right and the xenophobic position, and position from which it's very difficult to accept any type of reasoning about the role of migration, which is different from hate itself. So I think there is a lot to be done in that area in terms of informing. And perhaps one way to inform is really to really go to the personal situation of the individual citizens, inform them about what are their pension rights and what could change, especially in systems that are like the Italian, the Swedish system, or NDC system, so where there is a clear link between population growth, the wage bill, and your future pension entitlement. Should you really explain that if you get more people working, more young people working, their pension is going to be higher in the future, their own pension, their personal pension. So this is the type of information that I think may somewhat win be refused, that many people have in making the right connection when they're informed about these issues.
Thank you very much, Professor Boeri. And Professor Dasman, you have a paper on the UK, on the fiscal effects of immigrants. What do you find in that paper, and how can it help us to expect, to predict what the potential fiscal effect of refugees from Ukraine might be?
Yes, so first of all, it's important to define what we are talking about. So the net fiscal impact of migration is the aggregated difference between individual tax payments and individual receipts of transfers and benefits. Now, when we look at that, and we did look at that in the past, and we are currently updating that study. And the updated study looks at immigrants who came to the UK since 2004, so since enlargement up to 2019. And if we make that calculation, then we see that there is a huge fiscal net benefit from migration. That means those individuals contribute more in terms of taxes than what they receive in terms of transfers and benefits. But of course, these are very different migrant populations. They consist nearly half of EU migrants. The other half are non-EU migrants, but these are basically all economic migrants, migrants who came to the UK because of work, because they wanted to join the labor market. They very often came very well prepared, and they are very different from refugee migrants. So how big the fiscal cost is of refugee migration depends, of course, again, on the labor market engagement of the individuals involved. The more successful we are to integrate refugees quickly into the labor market, the lower will be the fiscal cost. That's basically a no-brainer. Now, that's why, coming back to the first point I raised when you asked me how should we actually address this situation, the labor market is important, not just as an integrator, but also to accommodate anxieties and fears of majority populations about the fiscal impact of refugee migration. The faster we bring people into the labor market, the better from that perspective as well. And we know from attitudinal data that the concern about the fiscal impact is a very important concern. It's a more important concern than concern about the labor market impact. And your own work has been also pointing in that direction. So people are concerned about fiscal impacts, bringing people into work, into the labor market, is of course very important to accommodate those anxieties.
Thank you very much, Professor Dasman. Next, a question to Professor Oriol, again to the other two speakers, from Alice Mesnard. Alice says, you talked about the benefits on labor markets that can be generated by refugees who integrate in the host countries, but in the short run, there are sizable costs to protect them and welcome them. Given that refugees are very unevenly distributed across host countries, where do the discussions stand at the European level about sharing these costs? Would greater transparency on this alleviate some political costs and anxieties in public opinion? And of course, we would like to know the specific experience of France, and given the recent French elections, whether there was any discussion of that in the debate.
Oh, there were no discussion about that. The discussion was simply that we are losing our identity and we are taking a risk for our security if we host immigrants in general. So some candidates at this crazy proposition to have zero immigration. So they want France to become North Korea. I mean, okay, that's really the plan. So that's the state of the debate. It's hard to know the fiscal cost of hosting this wave of refugees, but we have information on the wave of 2015, and the IMF had made some estimation. And for the year 2016, the estimation for the EU area was 0.2%, so it was relatively tiny. And with disparity, depending on the country, with Germany, it was close to half 0.5%. In Sweden, almost 1%, because they host a lot of refugees. In France, it was much cheaper. Right now, this is we mentioned that again. It's only a 2 months crisis. All the refugees they are located around their country in the hope to be reunited with their father, their husband, their son. I mean, the men are stuck there and they are fighting. So the cost is not evenly spread at all. And it is more at this stage, simply hosting people. Everything in their life is disrupted. I don't think they see themselves staying in Poland or in this country. They really hope to go back. And so the emergency is to help hosting them in this neighbor country. But I was mentioned by my colleague earlier on, I mean, how the situation will evolve in 1 year, we have no idea. If it stays like that, of course, the fact that they have been stuck for months in Poland, for instance, will be dramatic. I want to stress that every refugee crisis is the same. The refugees tend to stick in neighboring country. 70% of them are close by in neighboring country of their home country. So it is a constant of a refugee crisis.
Thank you very much, Professor Oriol. We're getting close to the end of time. So I'm going to ask each of you to tell us briefly what you would like us to remember from this discussion. I will start with Professor Dasman.
Well, yes, of course, that was all very interesting. I learned a lot from Emmanuel and from Tito and from many of the excellent questions which were posed by listeners to this discussion. So, what I find encouraging is that the way European Union has responded to this particular crisis is different, very different from the way it has responded to previous refugee migrations, in particular to the one in 2015. That is certainly very, very good. And I'm pretty optimistic that many of the issues which were also in the chat in the questions, like for instance, how do we redistribute the cost given that populations are very differently allocating across European countries. I think this will also be addressed. I think that the real big challenge is the sixth point I made initially, and which came up throughout the discussion, in particular when Manuel was talking about the French political situation, and that is the potential for a backslash, the potential that this situation will be opportunistically abused or misused by particular political movements, and how we deal with that. So there, I think, it is always very important to take seriously anxieties and fears and concerns of majority populations. We shouldn't wave them away because they can be very easily transferred and translated into political constellations we may not like in the end, and which may be very detrimental. So we need to take these concerns seriously, and we need to address them. We need to address them by having a plan, by openness, by transparency, and by a debate with those who face, who voice those concerns and who voice those anxieties. And we should do better this time than we had done in 2015 and 2016, but we should be aware that these issues will arise in the very near future and we should be prepared.
Thank you very much, Professor Dasman. Next, Professor Oriol, can you make some final remarks?
Well, thank you again for hosting this event. It was extremely interesting. I was happy to listen to my colleague and to have all the questions. I think I would like to summarize some key points that matter and that were coming out of the discussion. The first thing is the difference between the economic gain and the perception, the political perception of what a refugee crisis brings to the economic zone that hosts them. And as suggested by both Christian and Tito, I think transparency and information is key. Less optimistic than Tito about the power of spreading the information. I try that in France. I wrote a report for the CAE. I speak on TV. It has no impact at all. I mean, people are really blocked in their idea of what immigration is and how threatening it is and for their identity, for their safety. So that's very, very difficult issues. I think for this particular crisis also, what I would like to summarize is that it is very different from the 2015 in terms of composition of the population, in terms of acceptance by the EU people, because these people are not threatening for them men coming from Muslim country. They are women and children coming from a Christian country. So they feel it's okay. I'm totally agree with Christian that there will be a backlash at some point because it's a massive inflow and there will be some problem with schooling, with hosting them. So, to finish on a more optimistic note, I think we learn a lot. I agree with my colleague about that too, over the last 20 years. And I believe that what we learn is will be useful to deal with our moral obligation and international obligation to help refugees.
Thank you very much, Professor Oriol. And finally, Professor Boeri, please.
I also learn a lot from this discussion. I learn a lot from Emmanuel's contribution, also from your questions, Anna Maria, and what Christian said before. I think we are learning a lot from what CREAM is doing. So I should also stress that their work is really very important for us. I think that we certainly should do better than in 2015. And also I think that we can do better because this time the big issue is not the allocation. And there were a lot of proposals and discussions among the economists that were quite far from reality. Now that the task is to define schemes to better integrate the refugees in our societies, I think we have more to say, and there is way more experiments that are taking place throughout Europe from which we can learn. And we have the methodologies to learn from them. We have also the knowledge of the literature to do so. So I think our role this time is more important, and we should really work hard and humbly in collecting this evidence and bringing to the attention of policymakers, not denying the cons, but also suggesting that there are many pros in this experiment. So I think, and this initiative, this discussion is very timely and important. So thank you for organizing this.
Thank you very much. Thank you to all the speakers. Thank you to the sponsors and to the audience. Bye-bye.